Let's see if you're recording. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Alexander Azadgan, professor of strategic global management and international political economy, as well as editor at large with ImperiaNews.com and a senior geopolitical analyst with several global TV outlets like Press TV, TRT World, and China's powerful CCTV, among others. I just got off air with Press TV, another wonderful interview. What a blessing Press TV is. There's literally a handful of non-mainstream global news channels that you can get an accurate version of what, you know, what's really going on, in other words, reality. And I just got off air with them, so I'd like to pontificate a bit further, than what I was asked to pontificate on. Let me just get our wonderful, sorry about the spontaneity. I just want to repeat the question that they asked me, Press TV, using my surface here. Press TV's question was as follows. Iran's president slams Washington for his policies in the region, describing as illegal the military, the U.S. military presence in Syria. So why don't we just go ahead and just focus on that first, and then we'll spin the beans and then talk about all these other areas that they wanted me to concentrate on. First of all, Washington's, and you know, those of you who are not familiar with my work, I never use the word United States. I never use the word America. I always distinguish between United States and America versus Washington. The men and women, for most part, who are so-called representing us at Washington are not, in fact, representing the American people. They are representing major lobbies, MNC, multinational corporations, incredible corrosive elements, corrosive lobbies there, especially when it comes to our foreign policy in the Middle East. Therefore, I never use the word U.S. or America in a critical or downgrading way. Those of you who are not familiar with my work, both in front of the camera as well as our articles and books. So, going back to the military presence, our military presence in Syria is completely illegal. If people in the United States knew how our taxes are being wasted on illegal military bases in an illegal war, and I just said this on air, the military confrontation that Mr. Obama started in Syria, and we have to go back, it was Mr. Obama, and to some extent, we can go even toward the latter years of President Bush. That's when they were really planning for it. And there were some indications of instability they wanted to create. But literally, when President Bush came out of office in 2008, 3 years later, they started, CIA and Mossad, started this so-called Arab Spring, getting rid of Arab heads of state, which were, by the way, their own puppets. In Egypt, they got rid of Hosni Mubarak. In Libya, of course, their leader was not a puppet, Muammar Gaddafi, but anyway, from Tunisia to Egypt, and their grand prize was Syria. President Bashar al-Hafez, Bashar al-Assad, I was thinking about his father, Hafez al-Assad. President Bashar al-Assad was definitely not a puppet of the United States, but when they tried to get rid of these Arab heads of state and substituted with anarchy and chaos of their terrorists, ISIS, al-Nusra, al-Qaeda 2.0, as I call al-Nusra, and all these al-Sham this, al-Sham that group, it was ironic that Mr. Trump, it was him who pointed his finger at Hillary Clinton, rightly so. Many of us were wonderfully happy and surprised by the fact that he pointed his finger at Hillary Clinton and said it was you and President Obama that created ISIS and wasted $6 trillion. He actually used that figure. Now, he has a tendency, of course, to exaggerate everything, but in this case, he was actually right. And the American people, for most part, are peace-loving people. The big bulk of our existence as a country for, you know, soon to be 250 years, we have spent in war. So it is ingrained in our genes to be actually anti-war because we see how much of our taxes are being wasted abroad. But going back to Washington's military presence in Syria, completely illegal. If people knew that we are waging an illegal war there, if people knew that our soldiers, and this is what I actually quoted on air. This is a very interesting fact. ISIS, okay? Why are ISIS terrorists now only present in Washington-controlled areas of Syria. What does that tell you? What does that tell you? Why are they unleashing these people east of Euphrates? Something Dr. Zarif has mentioned, Iranian foreign minister, has mentioned several times. There must be a reckoning. Back in the 60s, I believe it was, don't quote me, in the early 60s under President John F. Kennedy, it was Stephen Hadley who represented the United States at the UN. And this used to be a very shy man. And he went in there, this is during the Cuban Missile Crisis. He went in there, presented evidence of what Soviet Union was doing at that time in the Western Hemisphere, especially in Cuba, and he shamed them and he took away all their credibility. I hate to say this, that it's time for us to have to be put into that place. I cannot wait for a day. And believe me, the momentum is building. The momentum is building, especially now that Trump wants to wage all these idiotic trade wars, not to mention the binging of sanctions. The moment is coming where Nikki Haley, okay, would be shamed at the UN for what Washington has been doing, causing mayhem, murder, terrorism, massive migration. We're talking about 6 to 7 million Syrians. We are not even going to cover the Afghanis. We are not even going to cover the people in North Africa or Iraqis who've been migrating and everybody else who kind of, you know, blends in with all these refugee crisis that we were all witnessing in the late summer of 2015. These people need to be exposed. These people really need to be exposed at the UN level with all the cameras at the Security Council, maps. We need a really good PR campaign on this because they are absolutely shameless. Absolutely, absolutely shameless. President Trump seems to point his finger at Iran and say, you know, put down Iran's presence in Syria. Well, you know, I hate to point the obvious. Iran and Syria have had a mutual defense pact for decades, for years now. You could even argue decades. Which means if either of those two countries are attacked, it is the responsibility of the other country to come to the other, to, it's a little confusing. If Syria is attacked, according to the mutual defense pact between these two countries, it is Iran's responsibility, according to that accord, according to that agreement, for Iran to come to the aid of Syria. Now, if Iran is attacked, Syria has the same obligation, except that Syria is decimated now. So, and that was the whole plan. They wanted to destroy Syria, so when they do attack Iran, there'll be nothing left of the Syrian Arab army to defeat whoever is waging war against Iran. That was the whole point of this mad, crazy war, which has caused the death of somewhere between 400,000 to 500,000 people. Death of 400,000 to 500,000 people. We hear figures of 350,000. Nobody knows, but the figures that we're quoting are from United Nations. So this accusation is completely illiterate. It makes absolutely no sense. I think this should be, the Iranians should do a better public relations job of pointing this fact out. If the legitimate government of Syria asks for assistance from either Iran or Russia or even China for that matter, that's not in works, but I'm just saying, then they could come in. It is still a sovereign state. Sovereign state, Syria is whatever is left of it, which is not much, is still a sovereign state. The terrorists are being cornered in Idlib, and I thought it was so, how can I put it? At the last Tehran conference between the Turkey, Russia, and Iran, the Turkish president was pushing for some kind of a ceasefire because the city of Idlib is surrounded from all sides, and that's the last strong point for al-Nusra and all these other Kurdish terrorists there. And it was maybe not so much the Kurdish, but mostly the mercenary al-Nusra and some elements of ISIS, whatever is left of them, that are cooperating with al-Nusra. I thought that was so hypocritical when later on those two countries, Turkey and Russia, came to an understanding and a ceasefire in effect, you know, edging Iran out. Because I remember watching this thing live on Press TV and President Erdogan keep pushing for a ceasefire, and the Iranian president, President Rouhani, was not so much in line with it. But later on, those two countries, Russia and Turkey, agreed on a ceasefire. What does that mean exactly? Well, Turkey is going to take care of its terrorists and get them out of there. Or we could argue that they avoided a bloodbath. If the Turkish supported terrorists sort of succumbed to surrender and left, maybe a bloodbath would have been avoided. And the estimates, nobody really knows. The estimates of the terrorists in Idlib, which was surrounded by Iranian forces and Russia was bombarding them, and then the number was anywhere between 10 to 60,000. The Iranians quoted a number of 70,000. So nobody really knows how many there were, but if they actually surrendered to their Turkish benefactors, I'm sad to say, even though Turkey is having major divergences with Saudi Arabia in terms of supporting terrorists, if they actually went ahead and retreated, well, that I guess you could argue that would have been a good thing. And I think that's why the Iranians didn't really oppose the ceasefire. At any rate, what else were we talking about on live air? Isolation of Iran is something President Trump keeps repeating, almost in a neurolingual programming, psychological warfare technique, PSYOP technique. I think it's President Trump that has managed to isolate the United States, managed to isolate the United States perhaps greater than any time in our history, other than not the Vietnam War, but Washington's war in Vietnam, which was from 1955 to 1975, according to all estimates. It is this president that has isolated us, really. If you took, literally I said this on air, if you took President Trump's what amounted to a hate speech at the UNGA yesterday, and if you actually substituted the word Iran, substituted the word Iran with U.S. or Washington, then whatever he accused Iran of doing is in fact exactly what Washington has been doing, not just since 2001 horrible attacks in New York, which resulted on an attack on Afghanistan that the deprived and the terribly leveled out country of Afghanistan, but also in 2003. When Washington invaded and occupied Iraq, and then in 2011 with the so-called Arab Spring, which resulted in the overthrow of President Hosni Mubarak in Egypt, and the same year they got rid of Muammar Gaddafi, and then they wanted to really, really try to get rid of Bashar al-Assad, the president of Syria, and all of that failed. But my point is that it is really, if you really literally take substitute the word Iran with U.S. or Washington, then that speech, all the accusations made sense. What are some of these accusations? I actually took note of it yesterday when I was listening to President Trump's speech. He called Iran the corrupt dictatorship in Iran. What about the corrupt oligarchy in Washington? And you, Mr. Trump, who actually have dictatorial tendencies. Literally, I mean, you have to listen to his speeches to get that. I mean, today's erratic press conference at the UN, anybody who actually listened to that, I hate to say it was laughable because it was actually really pathetic. And if you compare that with President Rouhani's sober-minded, clear, logical, well-informed geopolitically, well-informed, in the region, and also articulately philosophical, if you compare these two presidents' speech, it was a difference between day and night. One was malignant narcissism and just, blobbering, rambling on and just blobbing over it, and compare that to President Rouhani. And I'm not necessarily a fan of President Rouhani. My fans know I have been very hard on the internal policies of President Rouhani, but I'm of course completely in line with Iranian foreign policy, which Mr. Rouhani is part of. I'm in line with that because it's the right thing, because they're on the right side of history, and here in the United States we are not on the right side of history. At any rate, it was a joke. Mr. President Trump said repeatedly that people were laughing with him at the Security Council meeting earlier. No, Mr. Trump, people were laughing at you, just like people were laughing at you, including journalists in the room today when you were giving that ridiculous press conference. It was actually quite bizarre. I have never heard anything in my life as bizarre as this. But going back to the accusations from President Trump's speech yesterday, like I said, he called it the corrupt dictatorship in Iraq. What about the corrupt oligarchy in Washington? He said Iran is sowing chaos, death, and destruction. Are you for real? Iran is doing that? Iran is the stabilizing force in the Middle East. They're trying to clean up the mess that President Obama and Hillary Clinton started. It is actually Washington that's sowing chaos, death, and destruction by supporting terrorists. And then President Trump, of course, and this has been the old accusation against Iran that Iran supports Hezbollah. Hezbollah is actually a very, very popular populist, you can even say, movement in the entire Lebanon. Whether you are Shia, Sunni, or Christian in Lebanon, many people, the bulk, the majority of the Lebanese population, the overwhelming majority of the population in Lebanon are for Hezbollah, because Hezbollah is the only force that's really standing up to the state of Israel in the southern borders. And in fact, in the entire Arab world, the Arab masses, the Arab street is very much with Hezbollah. So you cannot, and their methods have changed, okay? You cannot call this organization, keep using the same old lines from 40 years ago and call this organization a terrorist organization and then accuse Iran of being a state sponsor of terror. And it is so infactual. It is actually disgustingly hypocritical. Not just hypocritical, disgustingly hypocritical. The Arab street from Morocco all the way to Iraq, and even Saudi Arabia in the Arab street, they applaud Hezbollah for standing up to Israel, especially because their own governments are, other than Syria really and Lebanon, everybody else is in bed with Israel. Saudi Arabia is in bed with Israel. Saudi Arabia is in bed in Israel against Iran. It's unbelievable. They rather side up with the Zionist regime than a fellow Muslim country. Jordan is in a quasi-state of peace with Israel. Everybody is, except Iran, Iraq, Syria, and Lebanon. What we call what they call the so-called Shia Crescent. I don't believe in any of this geosectarian vocabulary, lingo, or language. It is true Islam versus false Islam, period. True Islam being Shia and Sunni elements of Islam and all these other 72 sects of Islam, and a death cult from 300 years ago called Salafism and Wahhabism, which is the state religion. Salafist Wahhabism is the state religion of Qatar and Saudi Arabia. So let's go to another accusation. I literally was taking notes when President Trump was talking. Not respect, he said Iran does not respect its neighbors or borders, nor the sovereign rights of nations. This is absolutely, I shouldn't even dignify this hate speech, but I just want to, it's not about dignifying it, I just need to respond to it for you people, all 25 of you who are watching this. It's actually Washington that is coming from thousands of miles away and creating havoc, and it's Washington that is not respecting the sovereign rights of nations like Syria and Iraq, and also Yemen. By unleashing their vassal states, Saudi Arabia and the GCC, against the poor country of Yemen, where around 15,000 people have been killed, over 100,000 children are malnutritioned by Saudi bombing, and it's Washington who's coming from thousands of miles away and not respecting borders and trying to unleash their terrorists cross borders. The border between Syria and Iraq is a joke, thanks to Washington, thanks to the military bases that Washington has. Some of them in east, in south Syria, some of them in north Syria. All illegal, again. The other accusation of Mr. Trump, to spread mayhem across the Middle East and far beyond. Unbelievable, Mr. Trump. Unbelievable. If you had any mandate, you just lost it. Because a lot of your followers didn't want our involvement in this meat grinder that you have made out of Syria and Iraq. It's you. It's Washington that has been spreading mayhem across the Middle East and far beyond. What is far beyond? What's an example of far beyond? Ukraine. You don't have to go far. Ukraine. The poor, poor country of Ukraine that has been sort of is involved in a civil war right now. You had the head of the Donetsk Republic assassinated, I'm sure, with the help of CIA and other secret services not too long ago. It's like 10 days ago or 7 days ago. So it's far beyond part of spreading mayhem across the Middle East. It's your doing, Mr. Trump, and those neocons in Washington, which you, sir, have put into position. In the beginning, you had some bright people. You had people like Rex Tillerson, and I can't believe myself sitting here and defending Rex Tillerson, the head of Exxon. But compared to other people that you put into place, Mr. Trump, people like Mike Pompeo and John Bolton, these crazy neocons, when you selected Rudy Giuliani, a man who gets $150,000 a pop to speak in front of the MKO expat terrorist group in Paris, a group which has resulted, which has killed over 12,000 Iranians. I'm talking about MKO or MEK. A group which has killed over 25,000 Iraqis when Saddam Hussein was using them against Iraqi Shias and Kurds and Iranians themselves. 25,000 Iranians this terrorist group has killed. A group which has unleashed over 718 terrorist attacks. These figures are from the Association in Defense of Victims of Terrorism, ADVT. It's a very well-respected non-governmental organization, UN-recognized NGO. These are correct scientific terms. So when you have chosen Rudy Giuliani as your personal lawyer, and this is the man who gets $150,000 speaking in front of a terrorist group like MKO, who is the state sponsor of terrorism? Mr. Trump, in all honesty, who is? And another one, sending their proxies to wage war in an agenda of aggression and expansion. This is what President Trump accused Iran. Again, if you literally take the word Iran and substitute it with US or Washington, this is exactly what they are doing. Sometimes I think these men who write or women who write these speeches, they know of the crimes that Washington has committed. And they make a list of their own crimes and they substitute the word Washington or the word United States with Iran. I mean, it's laughable. The international community is laughing at this, except that it's not funny. It's not funny at all when you have caused the death of John Hopkins University 10 years ago, gave this figure of 1.6 million Iraqis that died as a result of Washington and George W. Bush and Dick Cheney's invasion and occupation of Iraq. That was 10 years ago. 1.6 million people died as a result of that invasion and occupation, and not all of it, of course, was committed by United States. Of course not. Nobody's saying that. But the civil war that Washington was waging over there, the geosectarianism, the Shia versus Sunni, Kurdish versus everybody else in Iraq, as a result of all this meddling, right, what President Trump called no respecting their neighbor or borders, nor sovereign right of nations. You didn't respect the sovereign right of Iraq. You didn't respect the sovereign right of Syria. Who are you to actually make such claims? And then I think these are the ones that I took note. I think after that I was so disgusted I couldn't follow the speech anymore. Or if I did, I didn't take any notes. All these false charges were used to justify Washington's illegal reneging of the JCPOA, which was a multinational international agreement between Iran and six superpowers. US is out now, so it's five superpowers. It's what we call P4 plus one. China, Russia, UK, France plus Germany. It used to be P5 plus one, the plus one was Germany. Trump illegally took United States out of the JCPOA, and it is illegal from an international law perspective. I was on CCTV yesterday and there was an international law attorney there and he challenged this point of view. I think it could be argued at the International Court of Justice, which the Iranians are actually doing right now. They have a lawsuit against the United States, United States, not just this administration, for reneging on his promise and coming out of JCPOA. It could be argued that this was an illegal move on behalf of President Trump and the United States to get the United States out of the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, otherwise known as the Iranian nuclear deal. So I hate to point this out, but the world's leading state sponsor of terror is none other than the the corrosive elements within Washington. And then they subcontract their work, which is state sponsor of terrorism, to their local proxies like United Arab Emirates, UAE, Saudi Arabia, up to recently Qatar. Qatar has seen the light and is pulling back and is no longer wants to be part of the GCC, Gulf Cooperation Council. Turkey has, to some extent, found the light and is pulling out of that. And of course, except the, other than the nations that I stated, of course, Israel, one of the greatest state sponsor of terrorism. So he did address the Yemen issue. This is a long commentary. President Trump did state Yemen issue, but he left out the Yemen conflict is waged by Saudi Arabia instead of characterizing as a civil war. It's a Saudi encouraged war. Not to mention that it's our military equipment, it's our American military equipment. And last year's $315 billion 10-year weapons contract with Saudi Arabia. It's those weapons that we are selling them that are falling on the heads of Yemeni people, Yemeni children. I quoted the fact that over 100,000 children that have been affected by cholera and malnutrition. So who is state sponsor of terrorism? He mentioned Yemen, but he mentioned all the facts out, right? When it came to Middle East, President Trump actually projected a false image that Washington is fighting terrorists. Nothing could be further from the truth that Washington is fighting ISIS, al-Nusra, etc. Maybe Washington is somewhat fighting ISIS now, but that's because ISIS started biting the hand that fed it. What else? He didn't mention anything. He mentioned terrorist extremism, but he didn't mention the countries that are actually supporting the terrorists in the region. And I listed to you who they were. He did mention North Korea. I'm going backward. He started North Korea in the beginning. I'm going backward in his speech and trying to point that out to you. He did mention North Korea, but he exaggerated what has been achieved, which is really not much. U.S. hasn't given anything to North Korea. There has been no bargain, no deal. And he actually mentioned that in his news conference today, that he hasn't given them anything. Nothing has been accomplished. Okay, symbolically, when the North Korean leader, Kim Jong-un, held President Moon of South Korea's hands at the DMZ, literally mark on the ground at the border check, when they held hands and they crossed the border, literally put the other feet across the concrete. How many of us didn't have tears in our eyes? But that's something that South Korea and North Korea achieved unto themselves. And in fact, South Korea and North Korea, and we could say East Asia, they're, how I'm gonna characterize this, I have to be careful. I like how tactful they are. I like how they try to resolve their conflicts without bringing Washington in, which Washington has been in there since the end of World War II. In Okinawa, in Japan, in South Korea, we have 30,000 troops in South Korea. Not to mention regular military exercise, which Mr. Trump actually was right. He called it military games. I think our colleagues, our counterparts in South Asia, in East Asia, do not want